So in this area, theoretical researchers were actually ahead of the practical world. And so sometimes this happens, sometimes you have the opposite, that theoretical world is behind on what the practical needs are. What this implies of being ahead, I will talk about it at the end. So this is based on this is a summary of a 6 hours talk. I'm not going to talk 6 hours here, but it also implies that there are certain things that I will basically refer to the references, which you will find at the end of the talk, you will find the references. So it will be more a summary. There are certain topics that we will actually discuss in full details. So I will start with talking about the enemy is in sight. Then what does that mean in the context of communication? And then I will focus on denial of service in communication systems. I will briefly talk about the complexity of the problem with an illustration. I will go back to classical results, which basically go back to graph theory. And from then on, I will start talking about the actual area, with starting with point-to-point networks. I will explain what point-to-point networks are. Partial broadcasts are different types of networks, which I also will explain. Then I will talk about potential applications. And only in topic number 9 will I actually talk about some techniques, as you see. So not too much techniques, more survey, but I will explain techniques. Also 10 techniques for general adverse structures are techniques. I will talk about implementations or a lack of implementations to be more precise, so you're prepared. The question 12 is a practical question, will make no sense at the moment, but will make at the time we arrive, and then I conclude. So what happens is that often people think that the enemy is the outsider, but usually that's not the case. So since 1946, the British knew that the atomic spies at Los Alamos were actually British, okay? So, and there were also American spies that actually spied in the Los Alamos. Many more got arrested. And so it seems the West repeatedly forgets that the enemy is actually in sight. And so we have many other examples, in particular when you look at spy cases as Kim Philby, who defected the Soviets in 1963, and you can go on and on and on with spies, and basically we repeat this mistake in the West all the time, that we trust insiders. So after the leak by Bradley Manning, what the US government decided to do is go for very harsh punishments. If you basically are an enemy in sight, they basically give you very harsh punishments. But that didn't help. So even putting Bradley Manning in solitary confinement before the trial didn't prevent Edward Snowden to actually make this leak that you all probably heard about or remember. And so since 1987, I've been thinking about it for a long, long time. My main line of research has been on finding techniques to secure IT systems in which we assume that the enemy is in sight. So I helped, for example, develop the threshold, the cryptography, in which one cannot trust all the devices that will be used for decryption or for signatures, either because their keys may have been compromised, or the manufacturer may have become an adversary, or the machine has been hacked. Let me tell you the following, that if you look at how easy is it to find that you actually are dealing with malware, so if you look at a Boolean circuit, and suppose that the manufacturer makes some optimizations, then the question is the implemented circuit the same as the design? That problem is co-NP complete. So that means that today nobody knows how to deal with that. And the other problem, if you look at one Boolean circuit, and the other problem is you look at algorithms, and And you have again the same question, is the implemented algorithm the same as the design? It doesn't have to be the same, it could be equivalent in the sense that for all the inputs you will produce the same output. That problem is undecidable. So trying to find very well-designed malware is not so easy. And so instead of actually saying we're going to try to find this malware, we just say it's going to be there. Okay? Which is a very different attitude. And so in my lecture, I will survey some of the research done to design communication systems in which we assume the manufacturer may actually have become an adversary and the equipment has been hacked. And so it's even stronger. We don't know in advance who the adversary actually will be. And I'm going to talk more about that. And so some concepts actually are borrowed from the reliability community. Because if you look in the reliability community, you don't know in advance what part of your system is going to fail. Okay? So these ideas of you don't know in advance what part is going to fail, you don't know in advance who your adversary is going to be. So what does this mean in the communication context? And I will give just three examples. DigiNotar, so you have to look at what lies behind there. What's the foundation for all this? It's basically graph theory. And so the graph may represent different things, which correspond to what you could consider as communication in which you send data, but it could also be virtual communication, as in the case of PKI. So the first example is DigiNotar. The other example is BT use of Huawei equipment. And the third is diverted Huawei documents when sending FedEx. So you're probably not familiar with any of these three. So let me give you this example. So DigiNotar was a certifying authority that was used by the Dutch government. And they claim it was hacked by Iran, but who knows? Okay, if you hack in a computer in Iran and then you hack from Iran, then everybody will say it was done from Iran, and so the Iranian will get the blame. So I'm not saying it was Iran, but that was a claim that was made. So whoever did it, they hacked this certifying authority, which then meant that if you actually are looking at Google, you actually now are getting certificates, but if you now have incorrect certificates, which were given out by a certifying authority, your browser will accept them, and so you can make a complete fake Google that looks exactly as Google, which your browser will not detect, but only contains 60% of everything else, and so the 40% is missing. Clear? So that way you can censor topics that you don't like, anything negative about Iran, or any document that contains Iran in doesn't appear on this fake Google. And people in Iran, when they actually use this fake Google, they will think they're using the right one, but they don't. Okay? So there is an example of a certifying authority that you cannot trust. And hacking has become very, very, very powerful. Today, the way PKI is organized, which actually was a major inspiration for some of the work we did in this area, is you can consider it in a graph, and then today the way we run PKI is that every CA is a single point of failure, okay? Which is the worst you can imagine. So usually you worry if in so system you have one point of failure. No, PKI, every node is a single point of failure. Have been designed worse, current PKI. We have proposed alternative PKIs to deal with this. So that's very virtual in the sense that the communication is basically finding out what the public key of a person is. You could say it's not a communication system. It's part of a communication system, part of a securing system. And very often people think that public key solves, a PKI solves all the problems, but they forget it's badly designed. And it's not resistant against attacks. Hacking attacks. So the second example is an old example. And so everybody talks about Huawei today, but if you look at the date of this financial, the Financial Times web page, It actually is from June 6, 2013. Okay? So more than 6 years ago. And even then, Huawei was in the news. And basically, the question then was, UK Security Committee shocked over Huawei contract with BT. And so a lot of what BT actually uses in Britain has been made by Huawei. And so that made the news then. Can we trust the Huawei equipment? So this is related to what you would normally call communication, but again, you're going to deal with graphs when you actually model all this. A more recent example happened when Huawei, but this time they were the victim, when Huawei actually was using FedEx, an American the courier. So you have DHL, which many people use in Europe. And instead of sending the packet, so they send the document from Japan to China, instead of sending it from Japan to China, which is very short distance, they actually send it first to the United States, and then it got lost. So people think it actually got opened and then all the documents read. So this is also, you can look at the whole FedEx network, it's also a graph. You can look at the DHL one, it's also a graph. You can look at all the couriers and all the way they're organized. And you could say, what are the edges in this graph? These are trucks, airplanes, etc. Clear? But it's all graphs. And all what we're going to see applies, whether you're dealing with public key, whether you're dealing with communication that you classically think about using a phone, using the internet, what you normally think about communication, or sending postal mail. Clear? All three will apply to what we now see. So there are many, many issues. And so I'm going just to talk about the denial of service during communication. What are the issues? So we have two types of network. There is the point-to-point network. The old-fashioned phone system was a point-to-point network where you basically would have a dedicated line that would go to a node nearby your home, and then from there it would actually go further, and that would be a point-to-point network. But often we actually use what we call partial broadcast. So broadcast in the full sense of the word, you could think about TV, old-fashioned TV and old-fashioned radio, but partial broadcast is basically when you use a cellular or mobile phone, then you do a partial broadcast. Also, if you look at old-fashioned Ethernet, there also you actually do the broadcast. A lot of internet technology is actually partial broadcast based. So those are the different networks. And when we have these different networks, then what happens is that the techniques that we can use to achieve the security differ a lot. Now, there's also the type of adversary. You could have a passive adversary who just wants to listen on to the communication. So if you look at the case of FedEx, there was a passive adversary where they wanted to find out what was being communicated. In the case of the use of Huawei equipment by BT, why that the British were worried is that there might be spying equipment in the Huawei equipment, spying devices, spying software, etc. I already pointed out that finding malware is hard. And so therefore, that's, again, the passive adversary. The adversary is just listening on. There's a different adversary which is active, which involves more hacking. And so if you look in DigiNotar, where you're going to say something incorrect, that is active adversary. And the DigiNotar example falls in that category. So also very, very, very old, going back to World War I, in networks are destroyed nodes, a node which has been destroyed by the enemy. So sometimes this is now called fail and stop. It just stops the communication. Now, one thing that I actually did not point out is that most of the work actually has been done on that the enemy is inside a node. But sometimes you may also have the enemy in a link, where your link cannot be trusted. The amazing thing actually after the Snowden leak is that the United States made a blunder. The people who made the press reports made a blunder about Snowden. The US government made a blunder. What was the blunder? So after the Snowden leak, they said that they had basically destroyed all the computers that Snowden had touched, and also all the Ethernet cables that Snowden had touched. So then they realized they had made a blunder. And so then they had to reveal that they know that basically you can put active devices in an Ethernet cable, and if you order an Ethernet cable over the internet instead of going to buy it in a shop, and the spying agency wants to spy on you, then that's one way. Even if you have a secure computer, if your Ethernet cable can be bugged. And so they put these bugs in the Ethernet cables. So links can also be taken over by the adversary. But there's much less scientific work that has been done in that field, and that's why it's between parentheses. And I'm not going to talk about links. There is one of the references, at least one of the references, that actually talks about that. So jamming adversaries, when you're looking at broadcast environment, mobile, cell phone, etc., then you may also have jamming. Jamming is a very old technique, but it also applies in that scenario when you're looking at denial of service. So as I said, most of the work has been done on nodes, so the nodes controlled by the adversary, but in some of the papers we also have looked at the edges or the links. Some textbooks in graphs theory call it not edges, but links. So the nodes controlled by the adversary, in the other case, will be the links. The best evidently would be to look at both, which so far I know nobody has done. They're usually considered to be a threshold. It means that we consider that two or three nodes might have been taken over by the adversary. And so therefore, we have what's called a T-bounded adversary that can control up to T nodes. This is a much more general structure, which I will talk about later on, which is called an adversary structure. Since I will talk about it much more later on about that, I'm not going to introduce that. There's a level of security which is perfect, which basically means that you will have, let's look at that further on, so let's not, I skip that for the moment. So there are two issues. There is issue of reliability, which I talked about a lot at the moment. There's also the issue of privacy. So you could say, okay, if we have a good PKI, then we could use public keys. But unfortunately, we don't have a good public PKI because it's hackable, which is a problem. And so if your security is not on the top, just a little bit below, then we have what's called delta reliability and epsilon privacy. Now, the people who actually made these definitions made the most crazy definitions you can ever make. And since they made the most crazy definitions, people now have to stick with that. And so the people who introduced that, if you have zero reliability, that's the best you can go. It's crazy. It should be called one reliability. Yes, so that's where we fell in that. I think it's kind of a trap. So also for privacy, if you have zero privacy, it's the best you can go, okay? It's the epsilon which becomes zero, but it should never have been called zero privacy. So if you have both the best reliability and the best privacy, then you have the perfect case, which makes it significantly less practical for just a slight improvement. And so I actually mentioned you who the people are who are responsible for this, okay? So the security of the sender receiver. So usually in all literature until a few years ago, people considered that the sender and the receiver use trusted equipment. And the reason is that cryptographers do not understand computer security. Okay? So I actually heard a talk given by a very famous European researcher in computer security, who in a talk said the following: after the Snowden leak, anybody on the street has understood that computers are insecure, except cryptographers. So I asked permission to quote him on that. He said, no, I have too many friends. So okay, I cannot say who it is. But I still think it's very good. And you clearly see that when you actually read papers in cryptography. They always trust the equipment used by sender and receiver. We looked at that and actually looked at what if you cannot use trusted equipment as a sender or a receiver. It's not very practical, but in extreme circumstances, it would work. So there are a lot of problems that actually have been addressed as decision problems versus search problems. I'm not going to mention them. They're also computational questions. So sometimes my slides contain more information than I actually will go over that. And since you will have a copy of the slides, I basically skip that. Constructions, sometimes we have sufficient conditions. Update the network is a very nice topic. Very little has been done on that. So when you have a network that basically can guarantee you the reliability and the privacy, now you want to grow it, how do you grow it efficiently? So that's the update question. But very little has been done on that. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about the complexity of the problem to give you an illustration. So what about the following solution? So the solution now is you have a network and you have adversaries inside. And so you want to communicate. And as I said before, if you really want very high security, don't trust the PKI. The PKI can be easily hacked. So what you would do, you would just send a message using standard techniques, using TCP in the olden times. When not receiving an acknowledgement, when you don't get an ACK, then the adversary must have control of the communication path. So then use a different path. Okay? And unfortunately, it doesn't work. So you could say, yes, if you use PKI, but so except when you have end-to-end authentication, okay? Which means that the party on the other side, you have exchanged a key with it, and that key you then use for authentication, so which is not trivial, except if you basically meet the person on your side, or use PKI, which is the itself-directed graph, then what will happen, the adversary will just send a fraudulent acknowledgement to the sender, and so the sender thinks that the message was received. And so the message was not received. You see, if the enemy is inside your network, the enemy can do whatever they want. So it's called active adversary. They just stop the communication. They send an acknowledgement back to the sender. The sender thinks it has arrived, but nothing arrived on the other side. Okay? And don't forget PKI, you can hack it. We predicted that in the 90s, we had to wait for DigiNotar for actually that to happen. So the solutions are not as trivial as people think. So the solution that we advocate, and there are other people who have been doing this before us, I will mention that, is basically heavily borrowing from the reliability community. So when I flew here to Italy, I actually flew an Airbus. So Airbus is the first company in the commercial sector that was fly-by-wire. So what means fly-by-wire? That means that there are actually three computers that check everything. So fuel consumption is three printed circuit boards. The route is also everything in triple, etc. And by preference, they buy them from different vendors, and they run different algorithms on these the computers. And so three computers compute the fuel consumption, the route, etc., and they do that all the time. So now they don't know in advance which one will fail. Okay? But when that one fails, one of the three fails, the majority will be the ones that are being used. So they will do a majority vote, and that's what's being used. And now what you learn in the first class of reliability is that the circuit that you build to do this voting has to be 100% reliable, which means very expensive in order to make sure that circuit that decides which one is correct, actually that one doesn't fail. So I'm going to talk about classical results. The issue of basically doing a denial of service is very, very old and was used by the British during World War I. And so they decided to cut the German overseas telegraph cables. There are very interesting articles that have been looked at military schools where they teach that this was a very good idea from a strategic viewpoint, etc. I'm not going to look at all the military things. So this is actually the ship. It was not a picture. It was able to come very close to the coast. You see here is basically the coast. These were the telex cables. And these were the balloons. And then they were actually being used to lay cables. It was a ship that was used to lay cables. And then they used the same ship to actually cut Germany off from the telex network during World War I. So this is a major denial of service. So let's now start looking at how you protect against denial of service. Those of you who have been in London, this is the a graph. This is a graph. But it's a graph of the underground in central London. Okay? Now, let's assume that you are the packet, not data. And you are, let's say, in Notting Hill Gate, and you want to go to Liverpool Street Station, and there is a fire in Oxford Circus. So due to the fire in Oxford Circus, there have been fires in underground stations in London. That station is completely closed. So no train can go through Oxford Circus. But still, you can go this way, and you can go that way. So those paths are called vertex disjoint. Vertex disjoint paths in graph theory have the property that if you ignore sender and receiver, that then all the nodes here are different from all the nodes there. Also, this path is vertex disjoint from the two others. So there are three vertex disjoint paths that bring you from here to here. And you see it's all graph theory, okay? And then when you then are going to look at issues as the communication networks, it's still going to be graphs. So now suppose that the adversary can be Byzantine. Then in order to only get reliability, you need 2t plus 1 vertex disjoint paths, respectively 2t plus 1 connectivity. So in this case, this was just destroy nodes. If you destroy nodes, then t plus 1 are sufficient because you will still have one path left. So even if there would be two fires, one in Victoria and one in Oxford Circus, you still have this path, and that would be sufficient. But if you're dealing with an active adversary, what the active adversary will do is send incorrect information on, let's say, this path and that path, then you basically get the majority here, the data. Now, this is a data network. The majority would be incorrect, and so therefore it would fail. So in case that you are dealing, you want reliability, and you have an active adversary, not destroying nodes, sending incorrect information, you need a network which is 2t plus 1. You need 2t plus 1 vertex disjoint paths. And if you want it from any node to any node, then that network needs to be 2t plus 1 connected. So that means that here, if there would be a communication network and you want to send data from Notting Hill Gate to Liverpool Street, that then you can only deal with one adversary. Clear? Because otherwise, you couldn't vote. It's the same as was being used in Airbus. You actually vote when you receive everything in triple. So it's what's called a repeat code in error correcting codes. And then you do the majority. And that's why you need 2t plus 1. And it's easy to prove you cannot do with less. So now I'm going to talk about point-to-point networks. And so what happened is that the results that I mentioned were very well known earlier on, but it was all related to denial of service and also what's called the Byzantine adversary or active adversary. Adding privacy to that was done in 1993 by Dolev, Dvorak, Wartz, and Yu. So they considered a network in which the nodes don't have a one-time path. They don't trust public key cryptography. They do not trust AES and triple desk and all these other things. And they were wondering, how can you now have communication between a sender and a receiver that haven't exchanged keys, and you assume that the adversary only controls T nodes? They have two solutions. I will explain one of them, how it technically works later on. So in the first solution, and they have proven that it's necessary and sufficient, they have no feedback. That means that all your communication only works one way, and there is no communication back. In that case, you need 3T plus 1 vertex disjoint directed paths from the sender to the receiver. Okay? So if you look at here, we had only the vertex disjoint paths from Notting Hill Gate to Liverpool Street. So it would not work on this network. Clear? You don't have enough. So this is an example of a K-connected graph. But I think I explained that with the underground network. So if you allow two-way communication, then two T plus one vertex disjoint paths are necessary and sufficient. Their algorithm was extremely inefficient. So if you want to look at making it efficient, don't read their text for that part. And we had to wait until 2008, don't forget that was 1993, until it was made practical. Practical between quotes. It's not too impractical. And it was done by Kurosawa and Suzuki. But this is very strange. Why? Because the receiver has to start the communication. I mean, kind of, when I want to send you a message, it's kind of, you need to start first. So I could evidently say, hey, I want to send you a message. If you look at the number of rounds, but still it's interesting that you can reduce the number of paths, vertex disjoint paths, making it more practical, but it basically comes at the cost is you need two-way communication. You could think about a lot on the internet today is two-way. Yes, but the internet is not point-to-point. Talk about that later. So I was talking to my former postdoc at Crypto, and I told him, I said, you know, these two cases that have been looked at by Dolev, Dvorak, Wartz, and Jung, and some of these authors are very, very famous people, they're not the most general case. And he said to me, you must be kidding, okay? Because these are very famous people. They forgot that general case. And yeah. So then he read the paper, and I had convinced him that they had forgotten case. So what they had forgotten is to look at the whole network and look at it as a directed graph, okay? And so a directed graph, if you drive around in Torino, then you will see certain streets are one-way streets. You can also have that on communication paths, that certain communication works one way, and then you use another path for the communication. So we look here at fast communication from A to B. We had N paths. And then we had U paths that were feedback, and they were actually the bandwidth of those we considered lower. And yeah, it opened a lot of the research that actually people started becoming interested in looking at more general cases than the two that I had pointed out before. So now I'm going to talk about the general adversary. So general adversary is very important if you buy equipment from an untrusted source. Okay? So what's a general adversary structure? So you're going to have a set P. It's a set of, for example, all the nodes and links. In practice, the work on links is very little. So in practice, unfortunately, it's the set of nodes. And then what's going to do? You're going to specify what subsets might behave maliciously. Okay? So as I stated before, the design allows for the possibility not to know in advance who the adversary will be. This is very, very important. Why is it so important to make your system such that you don't know in advance who will be your adversary? So the military in the United States during the 50s and the 60s had built up a whole system all assuming that the enemy was going to be the Soviet Union. Okay? And then the attack on September 11 wasn't by the Soviet Union, so they weren't prepared at all for this. Okay. Which was very interesting to see how much all this money was wasted without being prepared for an Al-Qaeda attack on September 11. So let's give an example. So if your set P is 1, 2, 3, then you have either an adversary structure, which is one alone. This could be the Soviets. But you could also have 2, which could be Al-Qaeda, or 3. And also, you could have then the supersets as 2 and 3 together will actually work against your the U. So then you have what's called the maximal adversary set. So that's 2 and 3 together and 1 alone. Because 2 and 3 and the empty set are subsets of 2 and 3. What's the empty set? The empty set is basically an outsider. So applied to communication, let A and B the sender and the receiver. And then what you're going to do, you're going to have basically, you're going to have elements in that set of adversary structure that themselves are subsets of the set P. And a necessary and sufficient condition for A and B to be privately communicated present of business adversary are the following. One, if all your communication links are two-way, then as was shown in 2002, if you take for any union of two bad sets potential adversary, don't forget that they can be more than one person, or more than one node, these two nodes could conspire against you, is basically the hardware or the software in there could conspire against you. So if you take any bad set, union any other set, that then the network should remain connected. Means there's still one path in your point-to-point network that you have left over. In one-way communication, it is basically the union of Z1, Z2, Z3, that then you still have a network that remains. And we were the ones who showed that for the network with basically no feedback. So this is very interesting because it looks very abstract. But if you think about who are the adversaries in the threshold case, in the threshold case we assume that the adversary can only control T nodes, so then that's a set of T. That is also a set of T, that's a set of T, and you have one left over, so this is 3T, and so in that case it says 3T plus 1, so you immediately see that this is the threshold case is a special case. Now, you could have other requirements as you only want privacy. So if you only want privacy and perfect reliability only, those only this case, that's case one, this is separate, another case, you find it actually in that paper for general adversary structure. Now, what happens is that later on, Perik, who moved from Carnegie Mellon University, Switzerland, has started looking at this issue too. This work predates Perik's work, but what Perik does, he says, okay, I don't trust this node, so I will go around that node. Yes, it's the same as I don't trust the Soviets, and so I will build everything to deal with an attack by the Soviets. But what if the attack doesn't come from the Soviets? Okay, and now when you think about that, if you think about structures that you build, and I remember talking to Fred Piper, who was helping the British banks in putting down an ATM network and securing it, then what happens is, he said, we never thought that these machines would be running and still be in place so many, many years later. Okay? So when you build an infrastructure, decades may pass, and who your enemy is today, maybe your friend and vice versa. Okay? That's why it's very important to have a flexible one. So sender receiver equipment is untrusted. I'm not going to talk too much about it. I'm just going to give you the reference for that where we looked at. Unfortunately, we need a human receiver and the human needs to do some computations, but we were able to check that computations actually were that humans can do that. So this is very, very slow, so it's only used in extreme cases. So now I'm going to talk about partial broadcast. As you see, I have not explained any techniques yet. I will go to techniques soon, except for reliability. So Franklin and Neur actually looked at the general case in which they said, suppose that I'm sending information, then there will be people who might receive the same information. Okay. And that then that actually allows you to exploit that. So, for example, we may have a partial broadcast. So if I send something to you, if I do that over this partial broadcast, you will receive the same information. So if I forward something, I cannot, if I lie to you, I also will lie to you. So that has impact. Because if you look at the point-to-point network, in a point-to-point network, if you would have a point-to-point network, then I could tell you 0 and I could tell you 1. But in a partial broadcast system, that would work. So therefore, the conditions change dramatically. Okay? So what they introduced is a directed hyper-edge in which you basically, they have an hyper-edge, but they made it directed. And so you have a node, and then you have the other node. So in this case, it would be me sending and then you two being receivers. And then you basically are the receivers. So, and then me, I'm the sender. And so the information is sent this way, and that's why it's directed. Okay? So for the threshold case, Franklin and Jung gave necessary and sufficient condition for privacy only. The other case is a very difficult case, and little progress has been made on that. Now they looked at the very special case, which is the multicast case. So the multicast case corresponds to the Ethernet. And in that one, they introduced what they called a neighbor network. And so Ethernets are a special case of these. So the nice thing is that if you have a neighbor network, you can use graphs. While for the other ones, you need hypergraphs. And actually, not just hypergraphs, they introduced directed hypergraphs. So in here, if you have this neighbor network, the easiest to explain is suppose that node 2 is going to send, then node 1 will receive it, node 3 will receive it, and node 4. So you basically have a graph. And then any node in that graph, when sending, all the neighbors will receive the same information. And since they receive the same information, you can exploit that in order to make the protocols more efficient. And the requirements become more relaxed. I'm not going to explain all these protocols. That, by the way, they have been improved jointly with the former postdoc. We improved on that work. And some problems in this area were finally solved by my former PhD student with some feedback from me. That was in 2011. So I'm now going to talk about potential applications. I started with PKI, so you immediately see that you can use this in PKI. And so interesting is that we wrote a paper in 2004, which is Israel Public Key Certification, the next target for hackers. That was way before DigiNotar, 2004. Still today, we're still using the same PKI, even though we know also people at Bell Labs, Stubblebine and Ryder and Stubblebine pointed out independently from us that in the current PKI, every certifying authority is a single point of failure. So what we proposed in 2004 is to use Scholars to model the CA platform. So if you are a PKI and you use a Microsoft platform, you get one color. If you are a certifying authority in the PKI and you're using a Linux one, you get a different color. So what this gave is actually this one here. And so inspired by this idea from the Airbus, in which everything is sent three times, instead of now just going to ask for the public key on one PKI system, we use three PKI systems, each using their own OSs, their own operating systems, and we'll only accept it if we get a majority being the same for the public key. So if Bob wants to find out the public key of Alice, he will basically, long time ago, IBM had their own operating system, this is finished. So here, I assume we have three because otherwise it doesn't work. So we have three operating systems which are very differently designed. So we have at most one that can be hacked. We don't know in advance which one. Very important. We don't know in advance which one is going to be hacked, okay? That's very important because we don't know which one are vulnerable. And so that's why we do it three times, same as for the Airbus. And now what happens is, so this is a Microsoft-based one, then the hypothetical IBM one, and then a Linux-based one. And then what will happen, the receiver of this information will do a majority vote, and then that's the one. So even if you have one node being hacked in this system, you can still use this. Okay? Very simple. So we proposed in 2004. Amazingly, this is not being used today. So now building point-to-point networks with untrusted equipment, we proposed that in 2005. So this is a very interesting network. It's just an example, okay? So we now do, we introduce a very special adversary, which we define as the caller adversary. So caller adversary is nothing else than a very special case of the general adversary structure, in which all the green nodes conspire. So if one green node is bad, the other green node will also be bad. If one yellow node is bad, the other yellow node will also be bad. And they may conspire. And one node may actually send correct information, the other one may decide not to do that, but they will optimize their attack. But we are not going to assume they may optimize the attack. We want to make sure whatever attack they do, that we will actually be able to communicate. So suppose now they do just destroy the fail and stop, so they destroy nodes. So they stop communicating. So suppose that red, as you know, when you go to China, red is a favorite color there. The flag is red, etc. So those are the Huawei routers. Then you could have, for example, these, the Cisco routers. Then I don't know whether the British Telecom makes routers. I presume not, but so those could be green, etc. So you have different countries that then have their own that have companies that work in these countries, and then you buy routers from them. So now, if two of these countries ask their manufacturer to stop communicating and conspire, there will still be one path from A to B. This is very different from the underground that I showed you before. Because if you look in normal graph theory, and you're looking at connectivity, you would say you don't need this. Because this, you either are going to have that one or that one, but this double would not work. Now in this network, because we have a different network, so it's not a threshold, we need both. If you remove this node, the property that if any two countries conspire and stop sending, so anything, for example, suppose purple and red conspire, anything sent from here doesn't go forward. If you want the property, any two countries conspire, you still have one path left, you need this node and that node. Okay, so that is basically what we now have obtained is results for such networks for the viewpoint of privacy with no need for having keys between A and B, so no keys in advance, and no PKI, because we know PKI is a network which itself is vulnerable for the same reasons as I explained here. Okay? And we can achieve end reliability and privacy. So that's basically what I'm going to say about that. So some techniques, I don't know how much time I have left, let me explain a few simple ones. So point-to-point network, Dolev, Workwards, and Jung, the result is very, very, very easy. What are you going to do? You're going to use secret sharing. So what is secret sharing? Secret sharing, I can easily explain. So what you do when you look at two out of n secret sharing, you're going to work over a finite field. You're going to put your secret here. Then those values are public. You call them x1, x2, x3, etc. And then these values, so you choose this line randomly, except that it goes to go to that point. I'm going to put it between quotes, random line. So then that becomes a share of party 1. This is the share of party 2, etc. And then it implies that from any two shares, you can recover the secret. Now, if you use polynomials of a higher degree, then you can make what's called t plus 1 out of 3 t plus 1 secret sharing schemes. So this is based on another analysis. This is called Ritz-Solomon codes, as was pointed out by McAleese and Sarwat. Shamir's secret sharing scheme is nothing else than an error correcting code. So you can use this as an error correcting code. And if so, you have the errors, you can decode them as an error decoder. Now, how important are error decoders today? Any of you having a mobile phone or having a laptop, error correcting is used in there. For the communication, we use error correcting codes. For storage of data, we use error correcting codes. So it's actually very important in current technology. So this is a well established technology. Okay? The receiver will just run a decoder, Ritz-Solomon decoder. The sender will just do semi-secret sharing. You have end privacy and reliability. So probabilistic action is basically what happens probabilistic. So here the problem with the previous one is you need 3t plus 1 vertex decision paths, okay, which might be expensive. We'll talk about more of these issues later. So there's a probabilistic solution in which you're not going to go for perfect, but just slightly less. Okay? And so what you're now going to do in that one, you're going to send a share. Again, it's all based on secret sharing. So you're going to send a share. You send that, A sends that to B. You're now going to send max, not the max that you actually do when you use when you look in most books on the cryptography, because they might be breakable. We use unconditionally secure MAC authentication. And then we also even send a key here, key IIA. So then we send on one path, and all the other paths we send keys to verify the MACs. So they are MACs, they are not hashes. They are MACs with keys, and they are unconditionally secure, means that they're unbreakable, even if you have a quantum computer or a more powerful computer. So what you do here, you may have an adversary inside. If you have an adversary here or here, that's why that key might be different from that key. That's why this might be different from there. And those then are the MAC, and there is here a key. And so now, what's going to happen is you can actually then verify whether this arrived correctly or not, and then you can do majority checks on that, and that way you can find out what the correct information is. So the protocol is actually very simple. So partial broadcast, Franklin and Jung, I will not explain, although it's a very nice result. If some of you want to see how it works, I can explain it. Well, we pointed out later on, so they actually proposed this idea in the context of partial broadcast, okay? But you can also use it in other contexts. And the interesting thing is that it protects you against the, you don't need to know who your adversary is. If you have a network and if you use their protocol, it only gives work for privacy only, not for liability, then it will give you the strongest security against the strongest possible adversary. So adversary independent, which is really nice. So techniques for general adversary structures, I already mentioned this. So we defined this as being the union of Z1 union ZT, Z2, where Z1 is in belongs to the first adversary structure and this belongs to the second. And then instead of saying, so 2Z, we can write that, and 3 write that. And so then we have the properties that I explained earlier on. So now if you look at the adversary structure, don't forget the core adversary structure is a special case. So when we have a graph and we let A and B be nodes, you can think about sender and receiver, then we will remove A and B, pointed out with my mouse. So we'll remove A and B from the set. And then we say that A and B are called Z separable in G if there is a set Z belonging to the adversary structure, such that all the paths from A to B grow to at least one node in Z. So we say that Z separates A and B. So if those nodes basically do fail and stop, you cannot communicate. And A are called Z plus 1 connected if they are not Z separable in G. The plus 1 is strange, okay? So some people don't like it because in the other case, when you have 2T plus 1, you have a number plus something. But this is an adversary structure plus something. It's just a simple notation. So it's just to make things easier to read. So I already explained to you if you want privacy and reliability, I already explained to you all these results earlier on. I mentioned them, I wrote them this. So the general case is feedback channels has not been studied. So there are many things still to do. Passive adversary, I'm not going to explain. It's basically using Franklin Jung. If I have time left over at the end, I can explain that. So it's basically the same protocol, amazingly, but now in point-to-point networks. So now, active adversary, we're going only to talk about reliability and no privacy this time. So there is an interesting lemma that says the following. So if we take, I'm going to use the mouse here. So when we take a graph and we have A and B nodes, and again we take A and B away, and let Z1 and Z2 be just adverse stress structure on there, then A and B are Z1 plus Z2 plus 1 connected, even only if for all set Z1 belonging to this adverse stress structure, there is a set Z1 of paths between A and B such that the paths in ZZ1 are free from the nodes of Z1. And for every Z2 in Z2, there's at least one path in ZZ1 that's free from the nodes of Z2. And that lemma, which is not too difficult to prove, the proof is in the paper, we exploited to actually make a protocol. And so we have the result, say, let G be a direct graph, A and B be nodes, Z be an adverse restriction on V minus AB. We have Z reliable message transmission, don't forget there's no privacy, from A to B, even only if A and B are strongly to Z plus 1 connected in G. And so the protocol actually, the arrow algorithm is actually a protocol, exploits the lemma. So we assume that A and B are strongly to Z plus 1 connected in G. We let S be a set of all directed paths from A to B. For each path P, A sends M A to B over P. Okay? So then B will receive MPB through path P belonging to S. So you see, it's not very practical because you may have lots and lots of paths. That's one of the problems. So improving these protocols is a major open problem. So B receives MPB through path B belonging to S. B finds a node set Z1 belonging to Z. This is a set, okay? Whose path set ZZ1, that was introduced in the lemma, is such that the same message MB is equal to MA is received on all its paths. And the claim is that MB is equal to MA. You find some explanation here. More is actually in the paper. I will skip the proof. So, oops. Okay, I already mentioned the color adversary structure, which is, and I already gave you this picture as an example. And this result I skip, and this result I skip too. So now I'm going to talk about implementation. So what do we know about implementations? So I had my former PhD student, Erotokritu, try to implement that. And in the 90s, I taught twice the course on networking. So I said, oh, you know, it's very simple. In TCP/IP, you have what's called loose routing. There's actually, you could go further and specify the route. But in loose routing, you'd say, use at least that node and that node. And you could also specify the route, but it says, suppose that doesn't work, let's just use loose routing, which is an option in TCP/IP. And so the amazing thing, it didn't work. And so the internet technology no longer allows to implement that. So in 1993, Dolev Dvorak, Warts and Jung proposed this theoretical paper. If they would have implemented it in 1993, it would have worked and people would say, hey, we actually like this. Is this room being used for another class? Is this room being used for another class? No? Because I see people standing at the door? No? Okay, good. So, today, this technology doesn't work anymore. Any router that actually has this option of loose routing, added to the packet, the router will just drop that packet. It's not forwarded. Okay? And the reason was that people reasoned that this adding this option could be used to divert the traffic. So what you could do, if you have here a path, and now you have an adversary, you add an option, that option, to the packet that actually says send it to that node and then to that node. And then here, this node can spy and do all kinds of other things, modify the data. And so therefore, they say this is a really bad option. We should no longer encourage this option. So on the internet, any packet today that has this option is dropped. So you cannot specify the route. So since you cannot specify the route as a sender, you cannot have vertex disjoint paths. No. Clear? And so therefore, the whole thing doesn't work anymore. It would have worked in 93, but they never implemented it. And so we seriously have a problem. Okay? There are many, many more problems that we've pointed out. As for example, companies want to keep their internet, internet providers want to keep their internet, the graph of that private, etc., etc., etc. So we hope that this is going to be accepted soon, in particular with this now becoming an important issue, and so that we can talk about all the issues. So it's a, actually, I think it's a 15-page paper or so that explains all these problems. So in our unpublished work, we used all this technology to receive privacy for email. So many, many people in universities now are stuck with either Google or Microsoft for mail as a server, cloud server. They don't. Many universities don't have their own mail servers as they used to 10 years ago. And so the solution what we propose is to actually use secret sharing and then to have two mail servers and use so it's basically privacy only, no reliability. We can have reliability, but my former student didn't do that. And so then what would happen is that neither Google nor Microsoft would be able to read your own email. Only if the two conspire against you would he be able to read your email. Okay? So what value of T should you use if you're going to go for threshold one? So in some totalitarian countries, the government has good control of the network. So what happens if the government controls all your network? Yeah. Then whatever value of T you're going to use is not going to work. So solution one, use the postal service. But don't only use the postal service, okay? Because if you only use FedEx, then that's a mistake Huawei made, and they should pay for it, okay? So don't only use FedEx. Don't only use the postal service. Use basically a combination of all these things. Use all this, but then other thing, you can also use pigeons. And so I was actually talking to my former boss who did a lot of work with, on that with me. And he said, Ivo, you must be kidding with pigeons. It turned out that both China and Russia still today have a pigeon network for very high secure communication. Okay? After World War II, Belgium used to be very good in pigeons. That's why so many pigeons in Venice. So they got stuck there. So the Belgium sold their military pigeon network to the United States after World War II. The record of the longest pigeon having flown was actually is in a museum in Paris where a pigeon flew from Vietnam to France. Okay? So pigeons have been used. Now you could say they don't work well. In 2009 there was a test that showed the pigeon could transfer a 4 gigabit flash. Now evidently today you can replace it with 128. Evidently you're not going to put the whole housing. You only put the inside and then you attach that to the pigeon. Imagine doing it by internet. It will take much, much longer. You could say, oh, the delay. Yeah, it's going to take a while before the pigeon arrives. But if you're looking at the end of your communication, if you use the internet, it's going to go slower. Okay. So for these networks are very good. And so, yes, so what value should you use for T? Don't stick on that. Look at alternative networks and use those. So conclusion. Building inexpensive operating systems and outsourcing communication equipment comes at a price. You can no longer address it. And for operating systems, that's what happens when you run a PKI, I mean a certifying authority. If you have an untrusted operating system, then you become an untrusted CA. And then for communication networks, and so I mentioned about Huawei. But also in China, China doesn't trust Cisco routers. Okay, so people in the West are worried about Huawei, but in China, they're also worried about Cisco. And there were actually newspaper articles that I didn't mention. But if I give, when I give this talk in China, I mention the Cisco problem. Okay, so for several decades, amazing, isn't it? Solutions have been under research. Unfortunately, they're going to cost, such as the need for redundancy and the need for reconsidered design of routers. In particular, due to the fact if you want to do that on the internet, you will have to go back to old-fashioned routers. Okay. The cost of communication is getting low. Indeed, Google Gigabit Fiber has arrived in Austin. Now also AT&T is competing with Google on that. The Google one is actually in very few cities in the United States. But Sony is already offering for a few years 2 gigabit in the Tokyo area. So what's the name of the area? The area is called Perfectly Secure Message Transmission. Okay. So, but I like to put the P between parentheses because in many cases we don't need perfectly. Okay, if you have 99.9999% reliability, that's fine enough. Okay, you don't need perfect. It should be considered seriously. Today it's easy to adapt multiple providers, so you can have landline and mobile, and so it is not so unrealistic as you would actually believe. So finally, although today's internet we have implementation problems for dedicated networks, PSMT, and I should have written that with P between parentheses, is highly recommended. As an example, China's quantum networks gives at best today the same security as link encryption, and link encryption has major problems. In link encryption, you have to trust all the employees in the so what link encryption does, it's so old nobody knows anymore what it was. So what it used to do, you would basically send your data, you encrypt it, and on this next node, it gets decrypted, re-encrypted, and then with a key that they share, it goes back to the time before public key existed, re-encrypted with a key which is shared between those two. Here again, decrypted and re-encrypted. That means that if you're a spying agency, the only thing you have to do when you have a link between Beijing and Shanghai is to put one agent in one of those hops between, and you can listen to all the communication between Beijing and Shanghai. Okay? So that's why they should use this. So PSMT would avoid that problem. And similar solutions could be used for dedicated, very highly reliable and private communication networks. And that's the conclusion. So there are certain things I skipped. As I said, this is a summary of a 6-hour talk. We started a little bit late, so I took it into account. And also I was told at least 1 hour, so we had at least 1 hour. There are many references that have been given here, which you actually can find more the technical data. So that's not it, there are many more, but so those are the ones that I mentioned in my talk. Any questions?